Hello, I'm Dr. Aley Kalapila from Emory University. In this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I'm going to provide you with a brief review on the treatment of Toxoplasma encephalitis in people living with HIV. This will be the outline of my talk on the treatment of Toxoplasma encephalitis in people with HIV. I will start with a background, followed by a review on clinical manifestations and diagnosis. Then we will hone in on treatment and medication side effects, and then finally, a summary. So let's dive right into some background. Toxoplasma encephalitis is caused by Toxoplasma gondii, which is a protozoal parasite. In people with HIV who have been previously exposed to Toxoplasma gondii, active disease occurs when the individual becomes very immunocompromised. That is, when their CD4 count drops to less than 100. Now, when this happens, the Toxoplasma cysts can reactivate and cause disease. The main symptoms associated with reactivation of Toxoplasma are focal encephalitis, but other clinical presentations such as retinitis and pneumonia have also been described. In general, though, with the widespread uptake of combination antiretroviral therapy to treat HIV, as well as the use of trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole for prophylaxis against the reactivation of toxo, the rates of Toxoplasma encephalitis have decreased within the United States. Moving along, let's now discuss some of the clinical manifestations associated with toxoencephalitis and review how you can also make a diagnosis. The most common symptoms associated with reactivation of Toxoplasma in people with HIV are neurological, specifically headache, seizures, focal neurological deficits, and encephalitis, so specifically fever and mental status changes. Now, as I mentioned previously, we rarely see disease outside of the central nervous system in people with HIV. On imaging, a CT or an MRI will show ring-enhancing lesions in the brain parenchyma. However, the important thing to note here is that an MRI is far more sensitive than a CT scan. So if you have a high clinical suspicion for toxoencephalitis and the head CT is equivocal or negative, you must obtain an MRI. The image on this slide is an MRI brain with contrast of a patient with advanced HIV who had toxoencephalitis. And as you can see, there are classic donut-like ring-enhancing lesions in the brain parenchyma. The diagnosis of toxoencephalitis is usually made presumptively. It is based on a combination of factors, which include clinical symptoms that the patient is presenting with, classic appearance on CT or MRI of the brain, and the patient having a positive serum toxo antibody, which indicates that they were previously exposed to toxo, and now the organism is reactivating and causing disease in this individual with a low CD4 count. Your initial workup should include checking the serum toxo antibody if it hasn't been previously checked, getting head imaging, doing a lumbar puncture if it is feasible and safe to do so. The CSF studies you are getting should be the standard ones that you would obtain when working up a patient with encephalitis symptoms, but specific to toxo, you can get a Toxoplasma PCR on the CSF. You should also do other workup for any other infectious pathogens that you are considering in your differential diagnosis of encephalitis in a patient with advanced HIV. Now, with regard to the Toxoplasma PCR from the CSF, this test is specific, but not sensitive. So if it is positive, then it's helpful. But if it's negative, it does not rule out toxoencephalitis, especially if your patient has other classical signs and symptoms and imaging associated with the diagnosis. The gold standard for the diagnosis of toxoencephalitis is the detection of the Toxoplasma gondii parasite on tissue obtained from a brain biopsy. But as you can imagine, this is a very invasive procedure and it is not usually required, since the diagnosis is almost always made presumptively based on clinical symptoms, imaging, and a positive serum toxo antibody. Now let's delve into treatment of toxoencephalitis. This is a table showing you your treatment options for the acute treatment of toxoencephalitis. This is the treatment that you will initiate once you have made a presumptive diagnosis of toxoencephalitis. The preferred regimen that is recommended by the opportunistic infection guidelines is pyrimethamine combined with leucovorin and sulfadiazine. Now, this is an entirely PO regimen. I have not put in details of dosing or frequency on this slide. For that, you can refer directly to the National HIV Curriculum Module on Opportunistic Infection Treatment or to the OI guidelines. Pyrimethamine is very expensive in the United States and may not be available at some sites. If you are at a facility where pyrimethamine is not available, you can use trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, which I will refer to as trim sulfa. Other alternative combination medication regimens are also listed on this slide, and they include pyrimethamine, leucovorin, clindamycin, or etovaquone on its own, or administered with other medications as listed here. Now, you will want to continue acute treatment for at least 6 weeks and maybe longer. The duration can be prolonged if the patient has extensive clinical and radiologic disease. Once the patient completes acute therapy, then you can move on to chronic maintenance therapy. So now let's do a review of the treatment algorithm for toxoencephalitis. First, you are evaluating your patient, and if their clinical syndrome, brain imaging, and serum toxoantibody fits with a diagnosis of toxoencephalitis, then you will initiate empiric acute treatment for toxoencephalitis. After 2 weeks of acute treatment, imaging should be repeated, and if this hasn't improved and or the patient is not clinically getting better, then you need to consider a brain biopsy to obtain a definitive diagnosis. If there is a clinical and radiologic response, then you can continue the acute treatment for at least 6 weeks. You may want to consider longer courses if the clinical or radiologic disease is extensive or the response is incomplete at 6 weeks. Now, after the completion of the acute therapy, all patients should be continued on chronic maintenance therapy. So these are some images of a non-contrast head CT and an MRI brain with contrast of a patient when they first presented with symptoms of toxoencephalitis. As you can see here, the MRI provides a much better visualization of what is happening in the brain parenchyma. So it is a much more sensitive imaging modality for the detection of toxo lesions. This slide compares two MRI brains, one at the time of toxoencephalitis diagnosis, and the second one after 2 weeks of acute toxoencephalitis treatment. And as you can see here, there is already marked improvement in the appearance of the brain lesions compared to what was seen at the time of toxo diagnosis. This graph shows results from a single retrospective study among patients with toxoplasma encephalitis who eventually responded to anti-toxo therapy. You can see here that 86% of patients had improvement in their baseline neurological symptoms by day 7, and 91% of them had clinical improvement by day 14 after initiation of anti-toxo therapy. This table shows you the treatment options for chronic maintenance therapy for toxoencephalitis. These are all PO regimens, and the drug choices are the same as your acute toxo treatment options. There are dosing differences, which I will not delve into here, but you can get those details by either referencing the OI guidelines directly or going to the National HIV Curriculum OI treatment module. Now that we have started maintenance therapy for toxoencephalitis, the next question is, how long do we continue it for? OI guidelines recommend continuing maintenance therapy until the patient has already successfully finished the acute phase of treatment and the patient has a sustained CD4 count greater than 200 for over 6 months on antiretroviral therapy. Some experts would also recommend full resolution of brain lesions, but this may not always happen. And also, there is data that indicate that residual contrast-enhancing lesions can persist for very long periods of time. If you've stopped maintenance therapy for toxo, it would need to be resumed if the patient's CD4 count is less than 200. As far as antiretroviral therapy is concerned, there is not great data on the timing for optimal initiation of ART. Typically, you should consider ART initiation within 2 to 3 weeks of toxoencephalitis diagnosis and treatment initiation. Immune reconstitution syndrome, or IRIS, that is associated with toxoencephalitis is unusual. Let's now discuss some common side effects associated with the medications used for toxoencephalitis treatment. With Trimsulfa, you can see renal dysfunction, hyperkalemia, leukopenia, especially neutropenia, hepatitis or transaminitis. And since Trimsulfa is a sulfur drug, you can get a mild rash, or you can get, on the more severe spectrum, Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Pyrimethamine, as I mentioned previously, is very expensive. It can cause nausea and vomiting. It can also cause bone marrow suppression if not co-administered with leucovorin. Sulfadiazine is also a sulfa drug, so it can cause a rash, leukopenia, or crystalluria. Clindamycin can cause diarrhea. Atovaquone does not have too many major side effects, but the vast majority of patients complain that it tastes bad. Finally, here's a summary of some key points I want to highlight. Toxoencephalitis occurs from reactivation of latent cysts when the CD4 count drops to less than 100. Remember that acute treatment is empiric. We base our decision to treat on clinical symptoms, characteristic brain lesions on CT-MRI imaging, and positive serum toxo IgG. The preferred acute treatment is pyrimethamine combined with sulfadiazine and leucovorin. If pyrimethamine is not available, you can use trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole for the acute treatment of toxoencephalitis. If there is no clinical improvement after 14 days, consider a brain biopsy for definitive diagnosis. Acute treatment should be continued for a minimum of 6 weeks, after which you would continue with chronic maintenance therapy until the patient has immune reconstitution on antiretroviral therapy. ART can be initiated within 2 to 3 weeks of the toxoencephalitis diagnosis.
The production of this national HIV curriculum mini lecture was supported by grant U10HA32104 from the Health Resources and Services Administration of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Its contents are solely the responsibility of the University of Washington IDEA program and do not necessarily represent the official views of HRSA or HHS.